Hi, good evening. You're watching The Digital Age, and I'm James Goodale. Why is there intelligence failure in the information age? 9/11 looks pretty much to me like an intelligence failure. Iraq, arguably a lot of intelligence failures. You would think in the information age, there's so much information around that it would be easy to find out what people are going to do to us. But that doesn't seem to be the case. And we want to find out tonight why that is so. And we have the expert of all experts to tell us. And his name is Bruce Berkowitz.
You're very kind.
Thank you very much for stopping by. Bruce, you are an analyst at the RAND Corporation. You're a fellow at the Hoover Institution. You're a former CIA agent. No, you worked for the CIA.
Many years ago.
You're around town promoting a book called The New Face of War.
Mm-hmm.
And next week, we're going to talk to you about The New Face of War. This week, we're going to talk about the issue I presented, for which you have a particular credential because you wrote Best Truth, Intelligence in the Information Age. Well, let's cut right to the chase, as they say. 9/11, in general intelligence terms, is an intelligence failure because we were surprised.
Mm-hmm.
The way we were surprised with Pearl Harbor. Now, there have been books written about how it happened in Pearl Harbor, but now you've had a chance to think about the intelligence failure. Why did it happen?
Mainly because we're facing a very different problem than we faced with Pearl Harbor, or for that matter, with the Soviet Union. In those cases, we knew who the target was and how to look at them. And so we built an organization that focused on those targets. And they collected very specific, really predictable kinds of information. And the challenge was distinguishing the signal from the noise. And so the way you solve the problem is you concentrated more closely on it. Terrorism is a different kind of problem. The threat can come from many different directions, from many different sources, and the type of attack they might use is kind of unpredictable. So you need a different kind of organization, and you need a different kind of process. The problem is different. You have to look in many directions, and instead of focusing on a given target and waiting for a signal, you have to collect a lot of information together and then pass it in front of as many eyes as possible, hoping that somebody will see the pattern. And the old style intelligence organization that we had and the old ways of collecting information sources that we had weren't up to the new challenge.
Okay, well now, most people in the United States think when we're talking about intelligence and they say, Bruce Berkowitz, he was the CIA, he was dropped by parachute into Manchuria. I mean, that's what
intelligence.
Intelligence makes people eyes glaze over much in this country as, in fact, the word digital age does. What's it all about? But intelligence, is it all from secret sources? Tell us a little bit, generally how we get intelligence. It's not about wiretaps. I mean, how do we do it?
The kind of thing that I used to do had a lot more to do with
Are you going to tell us?
Oh, yeah, sure.
Oh, okay, great.
The kind of thing I used to do many years ago when I first started in this business, right out of college, had a lot more to do with sitting at a desk than it did jumping out of the back of an airplane. The challenge today is, as you say, getting information from a lot of different sources. Now, at the margin, and often that margin is really important, getting that one particular source, that secret source, that agent that you recruit or that communications line that you tap, it can be really important. But these days, because of the nature of the threat, you need a lot more than that. You need financial data. You need social and demographic data to understand the target.
What does that mean, the demographic data? What were you doing? Reading books that I could have read?
Well, I'll give you an example. What kind of demographic data? You need to know that there's been this huge population explosion in the Arab world of 30-year-old males, and that they have failing economic systems and poor aspirations, and they're looking for some kind of rescue or opportunity. And what a lot of them are finding it in is in fundamentalist Islam. Well, if you don't do that step first, you don't know where to look. You don't know where to look in the mosque where the terrorists are being recruited. You don't know where to look in the communities where they're being organized, and so on.
So it's sort of simple in a way. All you have to do is figure out where the major trends are in the world and then convert that to some sort of a intelligence analysis.
Back when I started in this business about 20, 25 years ago, I had colleagues, and their job was basically, it was really very simple. It was, look at the 8th Guards Army in East Germany and tell me if they leave their barracks. And so you'd hire a guy to do that. A very straightforward problem. And you understand it. Sometimes it was hard to perform, but it was a very straightforward problem. Getting your head around this new kind of organization that threatens us, these terrorist networks, and how they operate in their tactics, it's just a much more complex problem.
Okay, so in the old days, what you're saying is you had a couple of enemies.
Mm-hmm.
You had Russia.
One enemy.
One big enemy.
And a lot of people,
you could focus all your energies on what's going on in Russia.
Mm-hmm.
Some say the CIA didn't even do a very good job on that, but putting that aside because the government was surprised at the collapse. At least that's what Senator Moynihan said. But you take issue with that.
Yeah.
But the point is, you could focus on Russia, but now you've got new trends all over the world, and they become localized with terrorists, which are just a couple of people. And how do they organize themselves, terrorists?
You know, one of the big mistakes that we made in the late 1990s was thinking that terrorists, especially these Islamist terrorists, were just a bunch of ragtag simpletons who had very little capability and just took cheap shots wherever they could find it. Not true at all, not true at all. They're actually, as you would expect from a lot of middle-class, relatively well-educated males, they were very sophisticated. They understood exactly how to use internet. They exactly understood how to use satellite phones. They understood how to use cellular. And so
can I interrupt just for
a
second on that point? It just occurred to me.
Yeah.
A former Secretary of State told me that the number two man at RAND, your sometime employer, said that the terrorists were much more sophisticated in the use of the internet and computer technology and information, whatever you want to call it, than we were. Can I just interject that as part of your...
I understand why he's saying that, because there's an element of truth in it.
Really?
Yeah, sure. The terrorist organizations are kind of like those geeky guys you see in Silicon Valley. They understand this technology, and they're very innovative in using it. Intelligence organizations, above everything else, are government bureaucracies.
Yeah.
And government bureaucracies do a lot of things well, but innovation and adaptability isn't one of them. And so intelligence organizations are locked into an old style of using information technology. Also, intelligence organizations they live and breathe security. And so they often see information technology as being a threat. It's a way of losing secrets.
Right.
And so the process, the whole procedure of getting new computers and clearing people to use internet is laborious and takes a lot of time. And they're probably about 5 years behind the rest of the world.
Okay, well, let's come back to this.
Mm-hmm.
Because we're presenting a problem and you're talking about part of the solution. But let's try to illustrate the problem even more. A couple of questions. How did we screw up? What's a quick answer? How do we screw up in 9/11? Was the FBI screwing up? As Mr. Benjamin, who's written a book about holy terror and religious war, and others have said, or did the CIA? Who screwed up? Who lost China?
Who lost China? You know, a lot of people are looking for the smoking gun.
Right.
A lot of people are looking for that one piece of information that if it had gone to the right place at the right time, it would have blown the operation. And they're looking in the wrong place because that wasn't what happened. It wasn't one analyst or one case officer or the lack of one piece of data.
Right.
It was a failure of the organization to keep up with the threat and the people responsible for adapting the organization
to
the threat.
I understand that answer. Yeah. And the answer, and I want to come back to it, if I may.
Yeah.
Among other things, because I think you were... Did I get this right? A Kent fellow at the CIA?
Yeah. Yes.
Was that recent?
Actually, it was just before 9/11 and just after 9/11.
Oh, okay. Well, so you've had a chance to look at the technology that the CIA uses, and I want to talk about that
I spent about a year just sort of looking over the shoulders of analysts and seeing how they did their work.
I'd like to talk to you about that in a minute, but I want to lay out a little bit some of the huge failures that possibly happen.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so your answer is we weren't up to snuff with respect to 9/11. Well, now, I think, I don't know if you agree with me, that there's an argument that there was terrific intelligence failure with respect to Iraq. I mean, there's some particular failures. Number one, we didn't know that the Iraqis had dispersed their weapons. I don't think anyone would deny they had weapons of mass destruction. But I think we thought they were in a more ready position to be used. We've been very surprised they've been dispersed, and they're very hard to find. We may never find them. We were surprised to learn that with respect to nuclear weapons, that the president apparently relied on, it's overstating a little bit, but there was a forged document upon which intelligence people and intelligent people relied with respect to nuclear capability of Iraq. And there hasn't been a lot of evidence yet that one has seen of the threat of al-Qaeda before we invaded. There is one now. Does that fit the definition? And the other thing is we didn't think there was going to be a guerrilla war, apparently. But more about that later. But is that intelligence failure?
Two different problems there.
Yeah.
One was, the question that Colin Powell put before the United Nations was, do the Iraqis have a nuclear weapons program, and are they complying with UN resolutions? And there was a lot of pretty good information about that, and he presented it.
Yeah. Well, I don't think there's anything.
Then there's a second question, which is, what exactly are you looking for? Is there a bomb in the basement?
Yeah.
And now, this isn't an intelligence estimate on my part, but what I think was going on personally was that, sure, they had a weapons of mass destruction program, but it was also wrapped up in the politics and the strategy of the Iraqis, which was basically to get rid of the sanctions.
Right.
So what they were really trying to do was to develop as much of the groundwork as possible so that when the sanctions came off, they'd have the weapons.
And there's no question they've been a violation of the UN resolutions. But I think the surprise has been that apparently the dispersal is so great that they're going to be hard to find if we ever find them. In other words, I think it's fair to say that the American public, most people thought that the weapons of mass destruction were in some form that could be utilized in a more ready basis than they are if it takes 4 months to find them. Do you think that's an intelligence failure?
You know, some people say that if we don't find the weapons of mass destruction really soon, that people are going to wonder whether they ever really existed.
No, I don't buy that.
Well, the thing is that we haven't found Saddam Hussein yet.
No, I don't buy that.
Nobody doubts that he existed.
I'm going to ask
finding a specific weapon or a specific production plant is really tough.
But shouldn't, I'm asking this question once more and then I'll disappear.
Yeah.
But shouldn't we have known that they had dispersed them, apparently, in a much wider way than we anticipated?
I mean, that's
intelligence, what I'm trying to get. Isn't that intelligence? We should know. Somebody should tell us. Nobody told us.
Well, that's not somebody actually knowing. That's somebody making a projection.
Yeah, okay. But
you could have a
source.
And a projection, well, sometimes you don't have a source.
Yeah.
What we did have is a lot of experience, though, because, for example, many people don't know this, don't realize this, but, you know, the South Africans actually had a working nuclear weapons program with about a half dozen bombs.
Right, right.
And not only was this not publicly known and not widely understood, but these weapons are so hard to identify and locate that when the South Africans tried to make the case that they had dismantled the program, it was hard for them to do that.
All right, well, let me, Pakistan and India set off nuclear weapons.
Probably atomic.
In your book,
yes,
you say that's an intelligence failure.
It was an intelligence
failure. Why didn't we know about it?
We didn't know about it because we weren't making effective use of all the sources that were available, including open sources, what the BJP was saying at the time, and because we were not sharing information effectively among the people who could have analyzed it and put the pieces together.
Well, let me see. I'm sorry. Did someone know?
Did someone know?
In the United States, did somebody know? I mean, how do we find, let's go through this sort of what's intelligence. First of all, we could found out if we'd had you parachuted into Pakistan, right? As a Pakistani, I mean, that's the CIA
human intelligence, is it not? Two, we could have found out theoretically by deduction from open source. It's very hard to do. Mm-hmm. Thirdly, we could have picked it up on what people call communications intelligence, mm-hmm. SIGINT, COMINT. Those are typical sources. Were those sources, any of those sources available to us?
You ask a lot of separate questions.
And, no, I know. I'm just trying to find out what we did wrong.
Let me pick a couple of pieces to it. Fact of the matter is that given the nature of today's targets, we don't have the kind of human sources that we really need. It's not just because we're not aggressive enough. It's because, again, it's a bureaucracy, the CIA, and the bureaucracy is accustomed to going after the Soviet target, and those were mainly intelligence officers and military officers. And so you could recruit them in the same circles.
Yeah. All right. The answer to this question is pretty much the same answer you gave me to why we didn't know about 9/11, and perhaps you'd give me if I could push you to it, but I'm unable to push you to it with respect to Iraq, which is basically we don't have an organization that can deal with the modern world. That's your answer.
The 9/11 failure really boils down to just a few basic problems. Not enough of the right kinds of human sources, because we don't do enough work under deep cover. Because we don't have enough of those sources, we weren't able to tap into their communications effectively, which is where you're going to get probably your best sources of information.
Okay, that's fine.
Yeah.
Now, let's take that thought and apply it to codes, because you have said there's a difficulty with respect to tapping into communications. Mm-hmm. Terrorists, apparently to your superior, the second in command of the RAND Corporation, have tremendous computer capabilities, and we have to assume that they communicate in code. Hmm. Is that a fair assumption?
Sure.
Yeah, it's a fair assumption.
Okay,
now, you tell most people on the street, hey, I've been doing this program on the digital age, and guess what? I've come to the conclusion that we can't break the terrorist codes. And they say, get out of here. Will you go away? I've never heard of such a thing. Am I off the moon here?
You know, there are lots of ways of breaking codes. And one way is with brute force. You get some good mathematicians, they figure out the algorithm, they just break it. The other way is to steal the code.
Okay, well, let's talk about
usually it's a combination of the two.
Okay, let's talk about the first. In your book, in your book, you say, effectively, the computer age has made codes unbreakable. I mean,
in principle.
In its principle.
Yeah.
Okay. What I'm trying to find from you, because you're really in the middle of all this, that's quite a shock, isn't it?
Again, though, in principle, they're unbreakable. But breaking a code is always a combination of sheer mathematical and theoretical understanding of codes, and also a lot of traditional cloak and dagger.
Yeah, okay, but listen about the cloak and dagger for a moment, because the way we've broken codes historically, as I understand it, is by intercepting them and giving them to a bunch of brain crackers, human or otherwise, and we break the code. Now, in the case of the...
Not always true.
Not always true.
No, not always true.
But true in the case of... it's part of the process.
You're probably thinking of World War II. And that's a good example because actually part of that was cloak and dagger because we had a lot of help from the Polish intelligence service, which worked with our people.
Okay, now,
and the British.
You will admit though, since you say in your book that the code's unbreakable, that they at best you can break them after a period of time, which is not probably fast enough. Mm-hmm. So does this give the terrorists a huge advantage?
Well, what you
just off the get-go? Yeah.
Well, what you have to do is you have to get to the communication before it gets coded.
Yeah, okay, but suppose you don't.
Well, that's why signals intelligence is a combination of technical skills and cloak and dagger.
I know, but look at 9/11. You talk about, and you've in your book, and you said here, that the terrorists organize in cells, right?
Mm-hmm.
And they communicate through digital communications, right?
Yes.
And 9/11, we certainly didn't get there before they communicated. So if we were to intercept that communication into a code on 9/10, it wouldn't do us any good, would it?
Well, what you want to do is you want to make sure that your only point of entry is not in the middle of the transmission, because if you get that coded transmission and you just happen to capture it,
it's too late.
It's going to be tough. And right. and so what you need to have is you need to have access to whoever is operating the, right. the computer yeah. for the terrorist okay. or whatever.
Okay. So I want to talk about that in yeah. just a sec. I just want to lay out how difficult the yeah. problem is in sort of the old, I think we would talk about SIGINT, which means signal intelligence. Mm-hmm. This is a difficult problem because, as you said at the outset,
always has been, always will be, by the way.
But hasn't it yeah. been amplified by the information age, as you yeah. said at the outset? Because rather than looking at the communications from Russia, mm-hmm. now we have a multitude of communications. And isn't that part of the problem?
Oh, that's a huge part of
yeah.
the problem.
That's what I'm saying.
Huge
yeah.
part of the problem.
Yeah. Yeah, that's the difference.
Yeah, the Soviet Union had a few bases around the periphery right. for the most part of right. their territory, and so you had spokes and you had long lines of communications and you had a good shot of getting the message.
Right.
Now the internet is so interconnected and all the right. You have cellular, you have satellite phones, everything's mobile.
Right.
And so just getting the signal in the first place can be pretty tough.
It's really difficult.
Yeah.
So when I opened the show by saying, hey, it's the information age, there's so much information out there, we think we know what everybody's doing. It's the reverse. There's so much information out there that we don't know what everyone's doing.
General Hayden, Michael Hayden, the head of the National Security Agency, has a phrase that he likes to use. And he says that in the past we were gatherers, and in the new age we have to be hunters. In the old age you could just collect a signal somewhere along a link right. and gather it in and read it or decrypt it or whatever you're going to do. These days there's just so much out there that what Hayden is saying is that you have to select your target very carefully. Right. You have to say that this is the person I'm going to yeah. listen to, or this is the yeah. cell that I'm going to listen to, and get your tap into that cell or that person,
right.
because you can't process all that information.
Right. But it's very hard to do because yeah. we're not looking at a nation of millions of people, Russia.
Mm-hmm.
We're looking at 3 people in a computer.
This again.
I mean, this is very hard.
This again is why.
It's frightening.
This again is why
we have
to have. We have to have the or
yeah.
Well, no, it's challenging.
I don't find
that easy, oh, okay. I guess. But this is why, more than ever before, you need to have the analyst and the human agents and the signals right. intelligence technicians all working
okay.
together.
All right.
Now really closely.
Okay, so I'm just pushing off a little bit the human agent part, because I think it's counterintuitive, but I don't believe that should be so. Okay, but what you're saying is it's not just laying a tap mm-hmm. into the terrorist cell, A, if you can find them,
yeah.
B, if you can decode them.
Mm-hmm.
That's not enough. We also have to have what is known as human intelligence. We've got to have somebody around who knows where the, well, you explain it. What do you mean by that, human intelligence in this context?
People who are very good at getting access to the enemy targets,
right.
the people.
Right. I want to ask you something.
Yeah.
I mean, that seems like a good idea, but it seems to me so hard. Now, there's a case. It's called the Scarfo case.
Yeah.
He's a mafioso in New Jersey.
Yeah.
And it turned out that, surprise, surprise, the government using the same techniques against the mafia as it is against terrorists.
Yeah, technology is technology.
Because the mafia communicate by code, too.
Yes.
All right, so They found out that Scarfo was communicating by code. It's called PGP,
mm-hmm.
pretty good privacy.
Mm-hmm.
It's the oldest, not the oldest, but one of the oldest forms of...
it's been around for about 25 years.
25 years.
Yeah.
And apparently it can't be cracked. But what did the FBI do? They broke into Scarfo's home mm-hmm. with an agent.
Yeah.
He put a program on called Project Lantern.
Yeah.
And then ran out. And because Project Lantern could tell the FBI, when they were looking at this undecipherable code, what in fact was being sent, they were able to decode. Now, so that's an example.
That's exactly the example of what we have to do.
Yeah.
And by the way, that basic technique has also been around for a while.
Oh, I'm sure.
Because the Russians used it against us in yeah. our embassy in yeah. In Moscow
right.
about 25 years or
right.
so when they
okay.
when they tapped our typewriters.
Right.
Same basic technology, but now that's the norm.
Okay, but
that's
what frightens me about that example.
Yeah.
And you're a CIA person, so we would expect you to emphasize human intelligence because that's what you guys do. Generally speaking, other than the NSA, which does a different kind of intelligence. Audience, if you understand that, come back next week and I'll explain it. But anyway, I think that's so hard. Here we've got mafioso New Jersey.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, we know who they are. We pop into their place. But now we have a billion Muslims, each of whom is capable of agreeing with his buddy to form a cell.
Yeah.
Okay. How am I ever going to break into that guy's home? I mean, first of all, I've got to be hep to the Muslim community. I probably have to be a Muslim. How do we do that?
That's the challenge. You need to have, first you need to have a good bunch of analysts who can tell you this is where you want to look.
Yeah.
And this is the weak point.
Right.
And it may not be obvious, because it may not be the top guy or the second guy, but it may be his sister-in-law.
Yeah.
And then you want to have a good technical guy from our SIGINT community saying, okay, if you can get me access to this person, I can give you a device or some kind of bug or intercept or whatever that will give you a stream of information. And then you get a human operator and says, well, I know how we're going to recruit that person.
But
that's the kind of teamwork that we need today.
Yeah, that's going to be it. That takes money, and the intelligence people get any money. Would you take the $160 billion in Iraq, if you had a dollar over given, and give it to the CIA?
A lot of it's going to the CIA.
Oh, it is. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Now let's get to your solution to this problem. Okay.
Yeah.
Your solution is an organizational one. As I said earlier in the show, you spent some time at the CIA, and you wrote an article based on your stay there that said that the technology at the CIA—can I say it any other way—sucked. Can you comment on what the future shows?
Your terminology.
Mine, you know, I've set my words. What's your solution to the fact that technology sucks, the organization sucks?
Fine.
Say that either, yeah. But it's not very good, I should say. What's your
solution? The organization, the people in the organization are some of the best that you'll find anywhere. I mean, if you go into the bowels of the CIA, the National Security Agency, the Department of Defense, and their intelligence organs, you will find literally some of the most highly motivated people that you'll find anywhere. It's truly remarkable. The problem is that these talented, dedicated people are really trapped in organizations that do not let them do their best work.
Can I just stop you for a second?
You're getting to the punchline here.
I'm going to let you get it in this context.
Yeah.
Why is there intelligence failure in the information age? And your answer is, go ahead.
The reason in this case why these people are not able to do their best work is security. We have not figured out how to reconcile the need to protect secrets with the ability to allow people to exchange information, adapt new technology, and use new techniques. Security freezes everything. It prevents analysts from talking to case officers. It prevents organizations from exchanging information. And it's not that there's a cult of secrecy. It's the rules of security.
Okay, so our problem, I want to thank you for coming by,
great
is
to
that
be here.
We think everything's too secret. We've overclassified, and we've got to change the culture. Is that fair, yes or no? Because we've got to say goodbye.
Yes.
More or less fair?
Absolutely.
Thanks a lot for coming in, Bruce. And thank you for coming by to watch The Digital Age, and come back next week to learn more about The Digital Age. For The Digital Age, I am James Goodale. Good night. Communicators who apply that concept to